break. Hurry, Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
So basically, you do the same thing as it at need. You would list everything out on the statement of goods and services. Some cemeteries will take prepayment for the opening.
Mm-hmm.
So that money you can take off of your bill and send it off to the cemetery.
Directly to the cemetery.
Everything else would be put into a trust account.
I realize that before we get there, I should just talk about if I just wanted to prepay, because I just want to prepay. You know, I've got a check and I want to give you a check, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I can do that at any time. Right?
Yes.
And that, but the calculation of that payment, you said, kind of comes off of some kind of list.
Yeah. So you decide what type of service you want.
Yeah.
So you list everything out, kind of an a la carte, if you would.
Yeah.
So much for this, that, and whatever. Once you've got a grand total, that's what the funeral is going to be.
I see. And I have the option of paying that up front.
So you have the option to paying it up front.
Okay.
You don't have to.
And if I pay it up front, how does that work?
The benefits of doing that is that you open up a trust. The money is always your money. It's in your Social Security number.
Mm-hmm.
It's in a trust company managed by this company. You'll get a statement each year telling you how much interest has been earned mm-hmm. on that money. In the interest that is earned on that money,
mm-hmm.
down the road, when the death does occur, mm-hmm. that interest usually takes care of the offset.
So that gets paid to the funeral home. To the funeral home. So that you can kind of lock in the price for all of these different.
Correct.
For all of these different items.
That's right. Now there's two sections.
Mm-hmm.
Again, there's the funeral home section and the outside section.
Mm-hmm.
The funeral home side, you can either price guarantee or not guarantee.
Yeah.
So at our funeral home, we guarantee the funeral home side, but the cash advance side or the outside expense side, we do not guarantee.
I see.
So for instance, at one time the newspapers had a set fee. Now they charge by the line. So it's much more.
It costs a lot more.
Costs more. If there's not enough money in that trust account, it's got to come from somewhere.
I understand.
So the family would pay the difference.
I understand. But you would lock in your piece of that.
Right.
And when you said they create a trust, where does the check go? If they would they be paying Slattery
they
Funeral Home?
They would be paying Slattery Funeral Home. We deposit it to a company that we use, and it's called Cooperative Funeral Fund.
I see.
They're in Madison, Connecticut, but the money is deposited to a Massachusetts bank, which is a state requirement.
I see. And I know occasionally people will talk to me about these prepaid trusts or plans, and they'll say, well, what if the funeral home goes under? This is one of the issues. Where does the money go? So you're saying that's a separate account. You're not holding it.
No.
And in terms of the ongoing management of that account, is there? I know that there that these are that you. This is regulated. This is regulated.
That's right.
I had thought it was by the state. You had indicated you believe it's actually regulated by the Federal Trade Commission.
Federal Trade Commission does the regulations.
And you said you regularly get visits from inspectors and stuff,
mm-hmm.
and a piece of that inspection is the auditing of that of those accounts.
Those accounts, and then in June we're required to send the state board, our licensing board, how many prearrangements you did that year, how many were pre-funded with a trust account, how much in life insurance, or how many people just came in and prearranged without funding.
I see. Oh, and so now you mentioned life insurance. So now let's talk about that for a few minutes, mm-hmm. right? I've had that situation where people have had life insurance policies, some with surrender value, some without surrender value. And in the course of doing some of this pre-planning, you know, we've talked about, I became aware of, I didn't know, the fact that in some cases these can just be assigned to the nursing homes. Can you just talk about that for a few minutes?
Okay. If it has a surrender value.
If the life insurance policy has a surrender value.
Surrender value. Usually MassHealth will want you to make the funeral home the owner beneficiary so that the family can no longer go in and withdraw funds.
I see.
Or take a loan from the.
Yeah, and you can do that. Is that a fairly easy process?
It's a very easy process. The family can just name the funeral home the owner beneficiary, and we'll use the life insurance policy
as part of the
Of the payment. Now just as long as the death benefit is greater than the cash surrender value.
I see, and I would assume that you would want to do that. And I suppose, to the extent that the death benefit was smaller than the total amount that was going to be owed for the funeral, then you'd want to get the rest of the cash to kind of supplement that, that amount.
Right.
Now, do you usually handle that in terms of dealing with the insurance company, or is that an insurance company?
The family would notify the insurance company because they're still the owner beneficiaries.
I see.
They would have to notify them, get the paperwork, then we would fill out. Right. They'll be looking for ITAX ID numbers and things of that nature.
And I will tell you, from doing, once again, a lot of mass health planning, the most problematic issue that we regularly encounter causing delays in having folks become eligible for mass health are these insurance policies. Mm-hmm. You have small insurance policies that oftentimes they're these old ones where you paid, you know, a dollar a week or so much a month, and they have surrender values, which mm-hmm. in today's dollars don't look that big. But to qualify for MassHealth, you have to have countable assets of less than $2,000. So these policies, dealing with these policies ends up just delaying this whole process.
Right.
So in many ways, you doing these kinds of assignments from the perspective of a lot of clients is the ideal solution.
Right.
It's much easier than trying to surrender it because, God forbid, the insurance companies hate parting with their money.
That's right.
So to actually ask them for a check, now it causes all kinds of stuff.
Right. The only thing is that sometimes the cash surrender value could be greater than the death benefit.
And how does how do you deal with that?
I suggest that they cash the policy and buy a trust account.
And buy a trust account.
Right. Only because if the person dies, you're going to get the death benefit, not the cash surrender value.
Right. And when you say buy a trust account, you mean buy these special funeral trust insurance policies.
Yep.
And I had mentioned to you when we were speaking, there are some concerns about that right now among elder law attorneys, because MassHealth in at least one case has taken the position that those are not valid. So if you have one of those, you may want to talk to your lawyer about it to confirm that what you have is going to work for the purposes that you want it to work. Alan, this has been incredibly informative. I remember when we were originally talking, you said, I don't have anything to say, right?
Right.
This is really, really important stuff, and I really appreciate your coming in. I'm sorry that Regina couldn't make it. Tell her if she ever wants to come in. We'll be glad to have her come in. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions about Alan is local, we'll see if we can, right in the program, provide a banner that shows kind of how you can reach the Slatteries. But in the meantime, you know, I hope that this has been informative, and thanks for watching this episode of Bergeron Briefs. Thank you.